This week on Maker Update, turning aluminum into an iPhone, a retro lamp from salad bowls, building your own FPV camera, and 3D printable board games. Hey, I'm Donald Bell, and welcome back to another Maker Update. It is our last show of the year, but that doesn't mean things are slowing down. We've got some incredible projects to show you, so let's get started with the project of the week. On the Strange Parts channel, Scotty Allen asked the question, is it possible to recreate an iPhone housing from a block of aluminum? We all know what it's like to obsess over a project that goes on longer than expected and swallows up more money than we planned on spending, but this project here crosses over into a heroic amount of patience. Scotty literally chipped away at this project for nearly a year, and aside from being an inspiring tale of engineering endurance, this video also explores some of the advanced manufacturing capabilities that make something like an iPhone possible. Even with access to a precision desktop CNC mill, puzzling out what combination of custom fixture and specialty bit to use to create overhangs and pockets for different components was a huge challenge. And if you've ever opened up an iPhone or really any modern smartphone, you know that hardly a millimeter of space is wasted. Every component, from the camera to the volume buttons, has a location carved out for it. To figure out that spacing and the depth of where holes and overhangs had to be placed, Scotty had to slice, scan, and digitally reassemble the housing millimeter at a time. And that's just the beginning of an incredible 30-minute video that took a year to create, and the result doesn't disappoint. It also proves an idea that was important to Scotty and I think marks a noteworthy moment for makers. It's this idea that, though it may be early days, we now truly have the ability to repair, replace, and reimagine our phones in ways that would have been unimaginable 10 years ago. Of course, that extends out to other technology too, and for me, that's a comforting thought in an uncertain world. More projects. On his channel, Wesley Treat shows how he made this retro Sputnik-inspired lamp. Now this is a project scale that's more in my comfort zone. In honor of classic American roadside signs of the 50s and 60s, Wesley is making an old school Sputnik lamp just to hang in the shop. There are some new school touches though. Most of the lamp is made from these large stainless steel bowls from IKEA, with a riveted aluminum belt in the middle to hold them together. But for the pointy bits, Wesley went with a 3D printed solution. Especially since the lamp is going to spend its life indoors, there's no real risk of the 3D printed plastic warping or cracking from sun exposure. It's a fun project, pretty approachable, and a great payoff for anyone looking for something unique and retro. On Instructables, a great tutorial from Max Imagination on how to build your own first-person view head-tracking camera system. This is a device meant to go in a drone, RC car, or robot, allowing you to see from that perspective. To build one, you need a combination of a servo pan and tilt mechanism, a wireless camera module, and the ability to transmit head movement and interpret that on a receiver. Max takes you through it all with a bill of materials, wiring diagram, and a 3D printable pan and tilt solution. Now for some tips and tools from Zack Freedman, a video on 10 board games you can 3D print and give as gifts. Some of these are simple prints that need minimal extra work, and some, like this globe version of Settlers of Catan, are formidable filament gobbling projects. Over on the Make Magazine blog, there's a great video from Elizabeth Marley on biofabrication. This was a talk given at this year's Maker Faire Bay Area, and it serves as a useful introduction to different ways you can grow and use fungus as a renewable material for making things. Different materials are covered along with their different strengths and weaknesses. Whether it's mycelium leather or bioconcrete, there are a ton of areas to explore in this field and some really interesting experiments. Gare's Tips and Tools newsletter has a handy year-end roundup of some of his favorite tool finds of 2024. Lots of items on here that are as inexpensive as they are unexpected. like a 2-pack of nail salon acetone dispensers that work great for alcohol or Goo Gone in your workshop. You can find a link to the full list down in the description. And finally, on our channel, Laura Kampf shares a useful tip on using fiber optic cable to route the light from indicator LEDs to another location. In her example, she has some powered speakers she's concealing inside a cool record cabinet. She doesn't want to see the speakers, but she does want to be able to see the volume and input selection LEDs that are built into them. Check out her short video to see how she was able to put fiber optics to work for a simple, non-invasive way to route the light from the speaker LEDs to a new panel. For this week's DigiKey Spotlight, don't miss Becky Stern's latest guide to addressable LEDs and how to shop for them. It's a confusing category to navigate, especially for beginners, because all of this stuff essentially looks the same to the untrained eye. Well, Becky's here to train your eye. How to tell NeoPixels from DotStar or DotStar from analog RGB strip, different density, different orientation, shapes, different diffusion, different voltage requirements. There's a lot to sort out, and Becky has you covered. All right, and that does it for this week's show. Be sure to subscribe, leave a thumbs up, leave a comment. Big thanks, as always, to DigiKey for making this show possible. Thanks to TMDC Workshop in Barcelona. Thank you for watching. Have a great holiday, and I'll see you soon.